Hello everyone, and welcome to the CSS Security Mini Briefing, where we will present a short summary of what was released today, April 9th, 2024. My name is Josh Daniel, and I'm a risk manager in the customer service and support organization here at Microsoft. We're going to start this video with an overview of the release, talk about a new item in the security update guide, and then we'll dive into a few of the vulnerabilities. Please note that the details of the vulnerabilities that we are covering in this video may change, and the authoritative location for information will always be the content in the security update guide. Before we dig into today's release, I like to compare it to the previous 12 months to see how it stacks up. With that, we have 150 new vulnerabilities in today's release. That's the highest that I've recorded over the past 5 years, and it's almost twice the average of what we've been seeing over the past 13 months. Now, I talk about the number of vulnerabilities each month, but that's merely a data point. It's not necessarily something that denotes risk. And what I mean is that a high number of vulnerabilities doesn't necessarily indicate that there's a high level of risk in the release. Like I said, it's just a data point that we can compare these releases to. Next, I'll talk to remote code execution vulnerabilities. These are the types of vulnerabilities that typically provide the most risk to your systems. They would allow a threat actor to install their own software or other high-level actions. This month, we have a total of 67 remote code execution vulnerabilities, and we've been averaging right around 28. So twice as much as we normally see. Now, remote code execution vulnerabilities, these do provide a certain amount of risk to your systems, and this is maybe a better data point when we look at the risk in the release than just the total count of vulnerabilities. Next, I'll look at scoring, where Microsoft uses the industry standard Common Vulnerability Scoring System, or CVSS. This is a scale between 1 and 10, where 10 presents the most risk. This allows software and hardware vendors to be able to compare and contrast different vulnerabilities across different products, services, and even vendors on a nice even scale. And what I mean is that a 9.0 vulnerabilities in Windows would typically present the same level of risk as a 9.0 vulnerability in Azure or a 9.0 vulnerability in some other vendor's product. This month, the highest scored vulnerability is 9.0 on that scale of 10. We've been averaging right around 9.6 for the past 13 months. Next, I'll talk about the average CVSS score, with this month coming in at 7.6 or just under at 7.59. We've been averaging 7.34 over the past 13 months. So just a little bit higher than what we've been seeing, but this is something that I would look to give a little bit better idea of risk in a release. We can see the average score is a little bit higher across the entire release. Now, when it does come to scoring, the CVSS score is a starting point. It doesn't tell everything about risk. It includes 8 different vector strings that are associated to a CVE that are able to provide the risk level to that vulnerability in a kind of a bubble, if you will. It doesn't include things such as the impact, the severity, whether it's publicly disclosed, whether it's known to be exploited out in the wild. So again, it's a starting point when we talk about risk, but it's not everything that there is when we talk about risk associated to a vulnerability. There was one vulnerability that was publicly disclosed in today's set, and we've been averaging just under 1. And there's one vulnerability that was known to be exploited at the time of release, and we've been averaging right around 1.6 over the past 13 months. Now we'll look at the overview chart where we put all of the products on a single chart, and now we're just looking at this release. And we typically put the Windows products towards the bottom of the slide to make it a little easier to look at, and that's no different than what we're doing this month. What is different is the number of vulnerabilities that are affecting Windows. We've been averaging 30 to 40 vulnerabilities, high 30s to mid 40 vulnerabilities, depending on the specific Windows product that's affected. And that's, we're almost at 90 on Windows Server 2022. Then we get into some developer tools such as .NET Framework, Visual Studio, .NET 6.0, 7, and 8, which all have some vulnerabilities that are being mitigated this month. There's a vulnerability in Azure Monitor Agent, a handful in Microsoft Defender for IoT. SQL Server has 38 distinct vulnerabilities this month, and that's one of the reasons for the high number of vulnerabilities. And we'll talk to that in just a few moments. But to round out the release, we have one vulnerability in Outlook for Windows that's being addressed. Now, before I dig into today's release, I want to talk to you about something new that Microsoft is doing in the Security Update Guide. And that is, we are publishing Common Weaknesses and Enumeration, otherwise known as CWE. These are essentially the root cause of the vulnerability or the weaknesses associated to those items. This is an industry standard that Microsoft is following and is part of. And this is the first month that we're publishing the CWE values. The Microsoft Security Response Center, or MSRC, has published a blog talking more about this. So if you'd like to know more about this, go and check out that MSRC blog. Okay, let's get into some of the vulnerabilities from today's release. The first one I'll talk to is CVE-2024-26234. This is an important spoofing vulnerability in the proxy driver component of Windows. This one is publicly disclosed and exploitation has been detected. This has a base score of 6.7 on that scale of 10. The attack vector is local, the attack complexity is low, high privileges are required, and no user interaction is required. There are no document mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. As far as affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in mainstream support, whether that's Windows 10 or 11 on the desktop side, or Server 2016, 2019, or Server 2022 on the server side. Next, I'll talk to CVE-2024-29050. This is an important remote code execution vulnerability in the cryptographic services component of Windows. This one was privately disclosed to Microsoft and no known exploits out in the wild. This has a base score of 8.4 on that scale of 10. The attack vector is local. The attack complexity is low. No privileges are required and no user interaction is required to leverage this either. I will point out that in order to have a successful exploitation here, a malicious certificate needs to be imported onto an affected system. It's a little bit of a speed bump, if you will. The attacker could upload a certificate to a service that processes or imports certificates, or an attacker could convince the authenticated user to import a certificate onto the system. Another thing I'll point out here is that the attack vector is local, but the impact is remote code execution. How that works is that the attack vector for this specific vulnerability is local. That is, that's the path that an attacker would need to use. However, Microsoft categorizes all of the arbitrary code execution vulnerabilities as remote because that is a little bit higher of a severity or a higher risk level when it's remote rather than local. And so even though in this case the attack is carried out locally, it could be that in the future a threat actor is able to figure out a way to execute this remotely. And so we want to categorize this at the highest level of risk rather than a lower level of risk that has to be changed later. So again, Microsoft categorizes all arbitrary code execution vulnerabilities as remote code execution, and that's the case here. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability, and as far as affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in support, whether that's desktop 10 or 11 or Server 2016, 2019, or 2022. Next, I'll talk to CVE-2024-29990. This is an important elevation of privilege vulnerability in Azure Kubernetes Service confidential containers. This one is privately disclosed with no known exploits out in the wild. This has a base score of 9.0 on that scale of 10. So this has that highest scored vulnerability in today's set. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is high. Privileges required is none, and user interaction here is also none. One thing I'll point out here, the attack complexity is high. And in this case, in order for a successful exploitation, this vulnerability requires an attacker to prepare the target environment in order to improve that exploit reliability. In that by default, it's not 100% successful every time that an attacker tries to leverage this. We're not providing those exact steps on what needs to be done because we don't want to give threat actors too much information and allow them to use this vulnerability in their attack chain. I will also point out that an attacker does not need to be authenticated here. There is a scenario where an unauthenticated attacker can move this workload onto a machine that they already control where that attacker is root. This is why privileges are not required in this case, because again, that workload can be moved to a machine where the threat actor already has access. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. The final CVE that I will cover today is CVE 2024-28906. This is an important remote code execution vulnerability in SQL Server, privately disclosed to Microsoft with no known exploits out in the wild. This has a base score of 8.8 on that scale of 10. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is none, and user interaction here is required. So one thing I'll point out here is that, as I mentioned during the overview part, is that there are 38 total vulnerabilities in the SQL area. This is one of those 38, so we'll talk to this one as representative of the other 38 vulnerabilities in the set this month. For this vulnerability, an attacker needs to trick a user into connecting to a vulnerable SQL server using the connection driver. In this case, it's an OLEDB driver. So make sure to update that driver if you're using it in your environment. The effective versions of SQL here that are listed, these are the versions of SQL that are in support. If you're running an older version of SQL Server, you will first need to upgrade your SQL environment to the latest version, or rather the version that is supported, and then install the security update on top of it. If you're already running a supported version of SQL, then it's only one step as far as installing the security update onto your SQL Server. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. As far as affected software, it's SQL Server 2022 GDR and Cumulative Update 12, SQL Server 2019 GDR and Cumulative Update 25, and the OLEDB driver 18 and 19. If you are a Microsoft Premier or Unified Support customer, and you would like to attend the full briefing call where we cover more content and are available to answer questions, you can either work with your CSAM to sign you up, or you can sign yourself up in Services Hub. All right, that's all I have to talk to today. I want to thank everyone for joining me as I talk about different vulnerabilities in the Microsoft products and services. I'll talk to you all next month. Thank you.